hour three of our radio program. Nice to have you with us on this Friday afternoon, this 12th day of January, the year 2018, as we take you home here, Brent, later on, with all the football, and away we go. Let me do a little potpourri, and just to get you off the football, not to get you off it, but just to sort of move it around a little bit and get involved in a couple of other things. Number one, the Australian Open begins this weekend. I'm looking forward to that. Djokovic is with Federer. Keep an eye on that. He's on that side of the bracket. So he is a floater and a dangerous one. He's the 14th seed. Fed is the 2 seed. Nadal's the 1 seed. No Serena. That begins on Sunday night. That's number one. Number two, the Cavaliers got to start winning some games. I mean, can't be losing by 34 points to Toronto after getting blown out of Minnesota. That team is too good. There's too much talent. I know they sleepwalk through the regular season because they know when push comes to shove, they're going to beat the Celtics. They're going to beat Toronto. They're especially going to beat Toronto. Toronto's had a great year. Now, they always do and never do anything in the postseason because, you know, they're relying on two little guys in the backcourt. There's nothing up front that they have to work with. Celtics, though, are a different story. Talented, good players. We all know about Kyrie. Two young players they play with as well, Horford, even without Hayward. That series could be a little more dangerous than normal. Now, remember, they had the home court advantage last year, and the Cavs still killed them in five games. So I'm not sure if that means as much, but Boston's a better team. But I'd be a little worried about Cleveland right now that has been drubbed 2 days in a row, LeBron yelling and screaming at everybody. So from that perspective, I would be a little concerned by that. Don't like what Kevin Keats did yesterday, the head coach of NC State. They began a program with that, calling a timeout with 0.2 seconds left. I'm okay with that, trying to ice a free throw shooter who was going to try to make his third consecutive free throw from three after he was fouled from three-point land, down by three, Clemson. But he riled up the crowd to make a lot of noise in the timeout and to make sure that there was going to be a raucous celebration. That was a Bush thing to do. You know, I don't mind a crowd doing that on its own. You know, if the scoreboard wants to do that, I can live with it. But you shouldn't have a head coach. Got to be above that. The head coach cannot do that. He's a young guy. Came from Wilmington, first year at NC State. Tough place to win. The Bush League. Kid missed the free throws. It turned out at NC State, survived by a point. Didn't like what he did at all. That's a no-no. Wouldn't see Krzyzewski do that, I guarantee you. And it's one thing to go out there and get the crowd ready to play some defense, rile them up on the last series, but not when a kid's making a free throw. I mean, that was Bush League, so that bothered me from that standpoint. So we keep that just it didn't sit right to me. If somebody gave you Darvish $160 million, and it sounds like the Yankees now, maybe they didn't. Who knows? If somebody offered him that kind of money, they need their heads examined. I don't understand the idea here that we have to give J.D. Martinez or you Darvish or anybody else. If any GM in the league or owner in the league goes out there and gives up that kind of money for a guy who's 30 years old and Martinez, would they miss the World Series with Darvish? Arrieta's another guy. I just would never do it. You know, I know Boris has, you know, a lot of these big clients out right now. He's not going to get anything signed until, you know, he has to even get close to the middle of spring training. He's not going to rush into it. He's got Moustakas. He's got Hosmer. Obviously, he's got Arrieta. He's got J.D. Martinez. He's going to take his time. He's going to be patient about it. But if I'm a GM or if I'm an owner, I'm waiting him out. If I want that player so badly, you know, let him go somewhere else to get his $180 million or his eighth year or whatever the case might be. J.D. Martinez has played 2 years in his career of over 125 games, or maybe it's only 1 year. He's had two good seasons. He's 30 years of age. He's a terrible outfielder. I'm going to, you know, he wants more than 5 years, a 30-year, he's 31 in August. What are you, crazy? Not a chance. And these owners have, you know, they have made a lot of bad contracts with older players, Pujols included. It has been a Verlander, Cabrera, you name it. I give you a million, Ellsbury, I give you a million guys who just aren't worth it because they break down and they're not nearly the same player in their 30s as they are in their 20s. And the ownerships have gotten a little smarter in the last few years here of not bestowing old players with long-term contracts. Hopefully that continues. I know a lot of people gave the Rockies grief about Wade Davis because he's, you know, in his early 30s. That one, and it said, how do you give him $52 million? They gave him 3 years, $52 million. They didn't go 10 years. They gave him 3 years with a fourth year vesting option if he goes out there and pitches well, which you'd be gladly pay if it was $14 million a year. So I don't have as big a problem with that one. And Davis is still great. But I would not, under any circumstances, I would not give any of these players the kind of money that they want right now. And what has been just a crawl in baseball as far as the offseason is concerned and the winter. It is very, 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 I've never seen it slower. Nothing has happened. You know, Stanton, of course, you know, Ozuna. The Marlins have unloaded players. Bruce finally got signed. But for the most part, nothing has happened. You know, and Ohtani got signed by the Angels, so I get that. But for the most part, nothing has happened right now. Trade with Longoria, but not a ton going on as far as Major League Baseball is concerned. So we'll see where that is developed. Then, of course, the four games this weekend in the NFL. You heard Phil there that last hour. Listen, you're going to hear the picks later. I think you know where I'm going anyway. Everybody's writing Tennessee off. Okay, Tennessee was into it last week. I tell you, they had a lot of enthusiasm. I think that team has a lot of belief right now. Probably won't mean much against the great Brady and Belichick and the Patriot machine. Patriots a little something to prove after that article came out and talking about dysfunction upstairs. I tell you, though, the Patriots are going to lose to somebody. I do not think the Patriots are winning the whole thing this year. Somebody will pick them off. Who, where, when, why, I can't answer it. But I do believe somebody is going to pick them off here in this postseason. And I'm not sure if Tennessee's good enough, so it may not be them. Maybe it will be Pittsburgh. And I'm not as high on Jacksonville as Phil is. Pittsburgh is going to... You know, they're going to score some points in this game. They're not going to go crazy, but you're going to have a tough time convincing me they can't score 24 points, a couple of touchdowns, a couple of field goals, 20 points, 23 points. And I have to see Jacksonville score 17 points to believe it. And I don't think Jacksonville is going to score 17 points in this game. Not with that offense. Marone's going to be conservative. Good play for them offensively is going to be a punt. So from that perspective, I'm not expecting much as far as the Jacksonville offense is concerned. And if you don't expect much from the Jacksonville offense, well, then I don't know how in the world you can expect Jacksonville to score that many points. I mean, if they're not going to do a lot offensively and play close to the vest football, that means from that standpoint, you're going to have to sit there and you're going to have to get Pittsburgh and quiet their offense down to 17 points. And I don't think they're going to be able to do that on Sunday afternoon. I think Pittsburgh's too good not to score something in this game. Something. And anybody who is screaming and yelling about this Raider scenario with the Rooney rule needs their heads examined. Especially the Raiders. They got an African-American general manager. They have Art Shell, who was there on more than one occasion. Al Davis never had any problem getting any misfit player-wise. He brought in many African-American from a standpoint of coaching and everything else. When I say misfit, I mean Atkinson and Tatum and people like that. No issues whatsoever with Oakland. And if he wants to hire John Gruden, he's allowed to hire John Gruden. So if you're going to yell and scream about that in the Bay Area, keep that in mind as you drive the Bentley up to Mill Valley for dinner. Keep that in mind. You're going to yell and scream about the Raiders now, not following the Rooney rule? I mean, they hired Gruden, and this is a franchise that has done a tremendous job with hiring African-Americans to important positions. And women, too. I mean, Amy Trask got a huge job there. 11 after the hour, we continue. Mad Dog Unleashed.